Welcome back. As you can tell by the intro of this video, we're doing another in my happy birthday ASMR video series. This one is for September birthday, and that is the September birthday of Jim Henson. I chose Jim Henson because he was such a major influence on my childhood growing up. He did so many projects that, you know, my childhood wouldn't be the same without them. I know he's before a lot of the youngsters' times, you know. I know he passed away about 30 years ago, but this video is celebrating his life, not his passing. And his birthday was in September, so this is for him. I have this graphic novel, which was published in 1984, and I've had this ever since about 1984, when I was 3 years old. It is the official comics adaptation of The Muppets Take Manhattan. And what I think is so funny is that I learned how to write my name when I was 5, so that would have been about 1986. And I can see that in pencil up here, I wrote my name and then I wrote "Don't Touch," T-U-C-H, because I think I thought that if my best friend, I know why, I can guess why I wrote it. I think I wrote it so my best friend Monique, who used to come to my house a lot, so if she came to my house, she would see it said my name, "Don't Touch," T-U-C-H, and she wouldn't touch it. That's what I, you know, thought at the time as a child, which I think is pretty hysterical. But I thought, in celebration of Mr. Henson's birthday, we would do a flip through of this graphic novel while I tell you maybe some facts that you didn't know about his life, maybe some lesser known facts, or maybe you just know his work but you don't know much about the man. So that's what we're gonna do. We're just gonna do a flip through of this classic graphic novel that I can't believe I still have it, but it was in my collection of childhood books that I still have. So we're gonna do a flip through, and then I'm gonna tell you some about Mr. Henson. So, Jim Henson coined the term Muppets, but he coined it in the 1950s while he was working on television. But what a lot of people don't know is that a lot of people thought that it was a combination of puppet and marionette, but he said no, it was really just a term that him and his crew made up. It had nothing to do with combining two words. Oddly enough, Jim Henson didn't grow up loving puppetry. He initially just saw it as a way to get onto television. And by the time he was in college, he had a 5-minute show on air every weekday, which is pretty phenomenal. Oh yeah, there's Kermit. Now, this is something that I didn't know until I did some research. Jim Henson made the original Kermit out of his mother's old turquoise coat. Kermit at the time, he wasn't a frog. He was just an abstract lizard with a dissected ping pong ball for eyes. And then over the years, he gained the frog collar. You can't see it in this picture, but he had the frog collar. He turned green and he got webbed feet and became a frog. But he wasn't initially a frog, which I thought was interesting. So this is showing you, this is pretty much just like the film, this graphic novel. So The Muppets Take Manhattan was my absolute favorite Muppets film growing up. So this is just perfect that I still have this. What I thought was so sweet that I learned was that Henson's creativity was inspired by his grandmother, whose name was Dear, which I think is wonderful too, right? D-E-A-R, that was his grandmother's name. She taught him how to draw and paint. paint and sew. And so amazingly, all those skills came in handy, right? And something you may not know that I didn't know was that he wore his beard, Jim Henson wore his beard to cover up acne scars from his teenage years. So I didn't know that because we all know him with that beard, right? That's just, that's so, you know, unanimous or, what's the word I'm looking for? It's, you know, you can't picture Jim Henson without his beard. So he did that just to cover up acne scars. Also something that I didn't know was that George Lucas consulted Henson when he was creating Yoda. Henson suggested his colleague Frank Oz that he should be the performer, and so he did. He performed it, he voiced it, he nailed it, and the rest is history. So I believe that was around the time that Jim Henson and George Lucas became very close. They remained friends, and also on the first day of shooting Labyrinth, you know, Jim Henson, of course, did Labyrinth, right? Isn't that another great 80s classic that we all grew up with? So on the first day of shooting Labyrinth, George Lucas arranged for Darth Vader to stroll over to Henson and hand him a good luck card. So that was cool because the two, you know, help each other out. Or at least Jim Henson helped George Lucas out, so. Just looking through some notes and page turning. Jim Henson was also good friends, but something I thought was interesting was that Jim Henson was also good friends with Douglas Adams, who you all know is another sci-fi kind of legend, right? You know, the author of the Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy. And they even collaborated on projects like the Labyrinth video game, which I thought was very cool. Oh, I remember the scene when they were all in the lockers. You have all seen this film, haven't you? If you haven't seen it, you have to see The Muppets Take Manhattan. The songs are incredible. The songs are fantastic. I love it. I was trying to get Alexa to play some of the songs for my son, but she won't play it. I don't know why. It's a classic. It's like the best Muppets movie. Yeah, I don't know why, but Alexa won't play it. But you can look it up on YouTube or buy it on a streaming app. But so something that I also found interesting was that Henson hired designer Don Sahlin, I believe his name is pronounced, to build many of the most popular characters. Sahlin perfected the sewing technique called the Henson stitch, which was a way of hiding fabric seams so that the puppets would look realistic on TV, even in close-ups. And the two collaborated to create the magic triangle, which was a way of positioning the eyes and nose and mouth of a puppet so that it appears that the eyes are actually focusing. So there was a science to it, you know, there was an art to making all of these incredible puppets. So this is where they're trying to get the job, they're all trying to get. And they go to that restaurant. I love the restaurant scene with the rats that serve the food. There was also so many cameos in this film, you guys. So many celebrity cameos that if you haven't seen it, you just got to see all the 80s greats that make, you know, make a cameo in this film. So. Something else that I did not know, I was a big Fraggle Rock fan growing up, just as a little girl. You know, I was like a 3-4-year-old. I loved Fraggle Rock. I was definitely an avid watcher of it. But did you guys know that Fraggle Rock was the first HBO original series? Oh my God, I didn't know that. So Jim Henson, you know, kind of pioneering with that, right? He created the first HBO original series with Fraggle Rock. And Henson, he, you know, he had a specific and somewhat lofty purpose in creating Fraggle Rock. He literally, This is what he said. He wanted to end war by teaching kids about peaceful conflict resolution, which I just thought was wonderful because I'm a very peaceful person myself and I'm very progressive politically, and he was too. He was very involved in the civil rights movement, which I just think is fabulous. I definitely think he was a very progressive, politically progressive individual, and I love that. He's so wholesome. I just love it. Something else you guys may not have known. Jim Henson wrote the 16-page treatment for the Dark Crystal while he was snowed in at a Howard Johnson hotel during a blizzard. So Dark Crystal, how many of you guys watch that? I mean, Dark Crystal, it's an 80s classic film. They actually have a golden book of it now. I have one for my son. So I think it's a bit over his head, because when you read it, it's just, you know, Henson created this whole new world with new words and vegetation and everything. So I think it's for a much older audience, but they made it into a golden book, by the way. So that's pretty interesting how he wrote the whole treatment for it while snowed in. This is cute because they include in the comic, they include lyrics for some of the songs about like saying goodbye. That's one of my favorite songs in the movie. And they include the lyrics in here. Kermit. Another piece of trivia that you may not have known was that another project that Jim Henson did, Emmett Otter's Jug Band Christmas. Who remembers that? Who loved that? I was a big fan. That was the first time Henson used radio-controlled puppetry, and the technology was based on the work of some NASA engineers, and it allowed for puppets that could row and steer in water. So that was a very pioneering project that he did. Oh, don't you remember the waitress and the dad? Okay, the dad's name was Pete, and I'm trying to remember what her name was. He should say it in here. I haven't seen this movie. I probably saw it the last time was like 10 years ago. I'm sorry, that's a motorcycle outside. It's late at night. I don't know why there's a motorcycle. I'm trying to remember what her name was. Maybe it will say soon. So, speaking of the songs on here, did you know Rubber Ducky, that song that Ernie sings, that hit number 16 on the Billboard charts? And then, of course, Rainbow Connection, that Kermit sings, it reached number 25. I play that song for my son a lot. Now, that one does come on Alexa, and I tell Alexa to play it for my little baby. Well, I call him a baby. He's almost four. He'll be four in a couple of weeks, but he's my baby. Four is still a baby to me. And he loves the Rainbow Connection. He loves a lot of those classic childhood songs, so... I remember when Kermit... Oh no, is this the part? I think her name was Jenny. That rings a bell. Does it say Jenny? Oh, Miss Piggy's jealous of her. Oh, this is a scene where Miss Piggy works in a, like a beauty counter. And Joan Rivers is the woman, you know, at the counter. So that's, I guess, supposed to be Joan Rivers. But it's really cute, the illustrations in this. I just, oh, so 80s, you know, it's like they weren't trying to be, to make the people look exactly human. They just did like cute cartoon versions. Oh yeah, when they go to that restaurant with all of the celebrities on the walls. Now, before he passed away, Jim Henson wrote up instructions for how his memorial service should be held. And so he was quoted as saying that it would be lovely if some of the people who sing would do a song or two, some of which should be quite happy and joyful. It would be nice if some close friends would say a few nice, happy words about how much we enjoyed doing this stuff together. So he was very humble about it. His passing came unexpectedly. To this day, we don't know for sure if his Christian science beliefs had anything to do with his passing, because they don't believe in interference of medicine. They say he wasn't practicing anymore, but that's what I always heard. I always heard that the reason he didn't seek out help sooner was because of that. So I don't know. Do your own research and form your own opinion, but I think it probably had to do with the fact that he was a Christian scientist. So, this was definitely one of my favorite scenes in the film. That's the first place that you ever see the Muppet Babies. The Muppet Babies were originally in the Muppets Take Manhattan. And that song is so cute. You can find it on YouTube, that I'm Gonna Always Love You song. Alexa doesn't play it, but you can find it on YouTube. So it's such a cute song. But anyways, Jim Henson got his wish, and you know, everybody had his funeral the way that he wanted it. And the most touching song that anybody sang was "It's Not Easy Being Green," which was performed by Carol Spinney as Big Bird. He ended it, because you know, it was touching, because he ended the song, you know, choking up by looking up and saying, "Thank you, Kermit," because the song was originally Kermit's, and Kermit, as we all know, we associate Henson with him, because Jim Henson created Kermit, and it's like they were one and the same, in a way, you know? So yes, you guys, I owned this graphic novel before I could even read. So this is so cute and so cool. And you know, I took good care of my stuff as a small child. Like I said, I was 3 when this movie came out. I wrote my name on the cover, but that would have had to have been when I learned how to write my name, which wasn't until I was about 5 years old. So that would have been around 86. So I still was loving this movie for, you know, a couple years or so. I have it on DVD, even though I don't really watch my DVDs anymore. Do you guys watch your DVDs? I kind of keep them in storage, and I just, you know, I watch things online now or on my phone. But, so we're getting close to the end of the film, close to the end of this graphic novel. It's not very thick graphic novel, but yet a lot goes on, because there's a lot of frames, right? So if you actually read this, it will take you a little bit to get through it. Oh, that's the somebody's getting married scene. That's another favorite scene of mine, when Kermit and Miss Piggy get married at the end of the series, at the end of the show, I mean. I wish I could have found my Miss Piggy doll, because I had a Miss Piggy doll. Or I have a Miss Piggy doll. I think my mother has it in her storage. She might have it in her house somewhere, but when I received it, you guys, I was very tiny. I must have been like 3 years old. And when I got it, like, my eyes swelled up with tears, because that's how much it meant to me, how much I loved her. So this is their wedding. I had like a massive Miss Piggy poster up in my wall of my bedroom as well back at the time. So I love Miss Piggy. I love Jim Henson. Oh, look how perfect this is. How cute is this picture? Oh my God, I love this. And I've kept it in such great shape for almost 40 years, you guys, because I was a toddler when I got this book, and I'm 40 now. So this is almost 40 years old. And that's the back cover. I Now Pronounce You. Yeah, Frog and Pig. So, I hoped you enjoyed that little tribute to Jim Henson. Maybe you learned something about him that you didn't know before. I mean, I sure learned a lot that I didn't know, and I mentioned a lot of great projects that he did. He contributed so much to my childhood and a lot of people's childhoods. He was similar to, you know, what, like, Mr. Rogers did, very similar, or George Lucas. Just a wonderful, just a genius, you know, we're so blessed to have had his genius, and it lives on, and the Jim Henson, company lives on, and that is incredible. So I had to share my vintage graphic novel that I've had since 1984 with you. I hope you enjoyed it. I hope it was relaxing. Thank you so much for watching. Please subscribe if you haven't already, and good night.